Our master used to say, initially we may follow, we get inspired by a master or by one reading or somebody's words. As we keep on doing it, the churning starts. And our effort should be to get more and more clarity on the goal to be scaled. If it is not clear, the discipline which we are trying to do, it may not become effective. Initially, it may not be very clear. What is it that is to be scaled? That the right concept should be formed. We have been blessed with so many things in between. We did not bring anything, nor are we taking it. We have to see that. So in between, everything has been provided to us through two institutions called Mother Nature and Society. The air we breathe, the water we drink, the earth on which we stand, the space in which we move about, the 98.4 degree Fahrenheit, that temperature that keeps us alive, the sun, all these are available, but for which we are, not we are. And again we look back to all the creature comforts that make our life comfortable. Anything you list. Right from the moment we get up in the morning, suppose you start listing it. The brush, the paste, the soap, the wash basin, the commode, the building, the electricity, the fan, the light, the dress, the chappal, anything. It is all given to us. In somebody's mind, the concept developed. After labor of love, it became an actuality. The society got it, you and I are using it. We are looking back at our own life. So many concepts keep on coming. We are trying to understand, what is this? I came with nothing. I have been blessed with these two institutions. And I am enjoying it. What should be my life? Suppose we are satisfied with merely enjoying it, then we will not be sitting here. We are not forcing anybody to have this question. The very fact that we are all sitting here, cutting ourselves off from the normal run of life and making it, whether we know it or not, it is an effort for self-discovery. If you are observing 1 hour silence, it is an attempt to... Somebody can say, go within. Somebody can say, we are watching yourself. Somebody can say, we are relating ourselves to the awareness in which every thought, everything, you know, floats. Somebody can say, I want to conserve my energy. Somebody can say, just watch, that's all. Let it go, any thoughts, let it come. Somebody would like to quieten the mind, stilling the thought, anything. So when we are in this, again we are thinking, why this question? Why this concept? What is the concept? What should be my concept? Why are we, what should be the aim of my life? Like that, so many churning will come. But for that, one discipline is necessary. For example, in our ashram, the mainstay is chanting of God's name. Any name of God. God stands for love. It's the impersonal aspect. God who stands for love. So, Gurudev used to say, initially, whether you have concentration or not, chant. Let it become a part of your life. After some time, he will say, mechanical chanting will not help. Try to understand whose name you are chanting. We are chanting the name of God. Who is God? Who is love? What is love? See, the churning starts. Today we had a discussion. Somebody was talking about attachment, detachment. Somebody was talking about selfless love. Somebody was talking about help, support. All these are expressions, you know. Somebody said value-based education. We are connected with value-based education. These are all words. What is happening inside? We are all sitting together, strangers, known people, but as if, you know, we have been knowing for ages, you know. Suddenly there is a bondage. What is it? We are trying to find out. What is this? When you start a discipline, sadhana, as you keep on, initially you need not bother about it, don't keep on rationalizing it, you will not get started. Somebody says you get, okay, your faith in somebody, you know, or somebody touches your heart and you are inspired, you start doing it. But as you keep on doing it, try to get more and more clarity why you are doing it. Is it for him? Is it for that person? Then we can drop it. Initially, yes. But later on we find, you know, something is in me also. Why? Somebody asked me, why should I do it? Achha, to respect his sentiments. Oh, why should I respect his sentiments? There is something common in me, in him. That is why I have to respect, you know. Start thinking about it. So going back to the first one, we came with nothing, we go with nothing, in between we acquire so many things, and it's all because of the bounteous gifts offered to us by these two institutions. What should be my life? Can it be a payback? Because of unidentifiable group, their contribution, we are enjoying it. Today the khichdi served, or the rice, you know. We don't know the Mahatma who brought this idea, you know. A journey from the paddy, dehusking, cooking, putting so many things, and somebody declared this is good for health. We don't know that Mahatma, no? The fruit that we cut, somebody declared, no, it's good for health. Who did that? We don't know that. Any item, you know? The plate in which it was served. We don't know which Mahatma conceived that idea. Can it be a payback? When I am enjoying every minute of my life because of the bounteous gifts by people who are unknown to me, who did not specify the beneficiary. Then if we start delving more and more and more and more, then probably we might get some clarity about our life, about the labeled spiritual goal. Actually, there is nothing called spirituality, or there is nothing called worldly. Everything is one and the same.
The concept is dvaita or advaita. What is that?
No, those are all words, you know. Those are all technical words by which we get stuck. If we forget about the goal and get stuck with the technicalities, we stay there. Srimad Bhagavad Gita or any of our scriptures, it all highlights or touches something that is common in all of us. That's called spirituality, you know, the spirit. That which makes us to utter these words now. That which makes everyone to feel that he is sitting or she is sitting or hearing, you know. That spirit, not merely the body or the thought. That one which presides over the entire sense of individuality. That is common in everybody. So that which relates to this common denominator is called spirituality. In order to make us understand that, they brought it in so many forms. Puranas, Itihasas, Upanishads, Srimad Bhagavad Gita, so many. But unfortunately, you know, we got stuck with the technicalities. And then we are somewhere, and this is a bookish knowledge, academic knowledge. Those are all helpful, no doubt. Helpful if we rightly go that. But our whole aim should be to know this, to feel this oneness. Every one of us. The very fact that all of us are sitting here is an undefined attempt to know the commonness, to enjoy that commonness, which is called fraternity or something, you know. Why? This is spirituality. If you take every stanza in Bhagavad Gita, ultimately it will lead to this. According to our shastras or traditions, we know, you know, everything is prescripted. Because none of us decided anything. So there is some force, we can call it as God, anything, you know, some unknown, undefinable force is there. We will try to find out that. Who is it that at the moment assuming himself as me now? Suppose we start doing it, you know, somewhere we may reach. So you are telling about birthday. Birthday is an occasion where we express our gratitude. Somebody was expressing his gratitude, no? For all the bounteous gifts that has been given to us. And in that process, nobody said you should not earn. Nobody said you should not enjoy. What should be more predominant in us is, we are always conscious of the bounteous gifts given to us by these two institutions. So our life should become a payback, whether we like it or not. And in that process, whatever objects, emotions, thoughts that are to be possessed for some time and can lift it late, just be, when we get into a train, till you get down, you know, you become so close with everybody. You share everything, you trust, you believe, so many things, you know. After that you pass away and you may not meet him again. So during that moment, whatever is there, we will enjoy, nothing wrong in it. So that is why our Shastras have also said the Dharma Artha Kama Moksha. These are called the four E's. Ethics, earning, enjoyment and emancipation. So when we are children, we ethics, you know, ethics is that which binds me together. I am what I am because of these things. So when I go along with this, it's called ethics. I ensure that none of my thoughts, words and deeds prove to be detrimental to the interest of any other creation. This is what is called ethics or values, whatever you call it. Based upon that, I can earn. Based upon that, I can enjoy. I have been given the sense organs, sense objects are there. But based upon ethics. Earning based upon ethics. As we keep on traveling, still we feel something is missing. In spite of your righteous earning, righteous living, still you find something is missing in your life as you pass through certain age. Then, you know, you start thinking, what is this? Then the question of emancipation also comes. So nothing is taboo here. We are not going to compartmentalize materialism, spirituality, nothing like that. When you handle everything with the right concept, everything has got its own relevance. Money is needed, no doubt. Money is needed for what? That's the question. So for that I have to earn. I must keep on defining the purpose of wealth. Wealth is not an undesirable thing. When I own it in the form of a trusteeship, absolutely it is correct. It has been given to me. When you are a trustee, you know, you may be handling it. You are the deciding factor. Suppose you are a bank employee. You can decide to whom the loan should be given. But you cannot touch it, you know. And you have to protect it, protect the interest of the depositor also. But at the same time, you can decide. You can be instrumental in giving life to so many. But at the same time, you know very well, you cannot touch it for your purpose. Suppose when I start developing this idea, I may not tom-tom it. Money is needed, no? Wealth is needed. Somebody is providing a space for us to discuss now, you know. We are not sitting on the air or the space. So somebody has to do it. So wealth is not taboo or nothing is taboo. It all depends upon our attitude. So if we start, you know, all these processes will come one by one. The self-inquiry will come one by one. We are very happy that all of us are sitting for 1 hour. And this 1 hour inward journey, if you can call it an inward journey, or some exercise, you know, by which, that will help us to rediscover ourselves. We have some notion about ourselves, each one of us, an assumed image of ourselves. This process will slowly pave the way to know all these things. Even all our spiritual discipline, you know, it should end in this self-inquiry. All. Even our master used to say, chanting of God's name will. Utterance of God's name should make the mind ultimately still, free from all thoughts. It is in that stillness you know and realize the presence of God. Everywhere, no? This is the final. Because here, you know, we are trying to understand. All these questions will keep on coming. Our stored up knowledge about spirituality, our concept about spirituality, our concept about real life, the challenges, the duties, everything will keep on coming during this 1 hour session. And then we will try to find out. And to many of us, probably after two or three or four sessions, slowly the awareness will well up. You become the awareness becomes aware of the aware of the thoughts. Because somebody is aware, you know, one thought is going, we name it as downpulling, another thought is coming, it's evolving thoughts, so many, you know, but all the same it is a thought. So this awareness wells up. Suddenly the sense of individuality effaces itself for a second or for a trice. Again another thought comes and you are again back to yourself. But when that stage comes, you know, next Wednesday session, probably a little more. Another next Friday session, a little more. And you will find amazingly more and more clarity is coming to us. Sukshma Sharira, they say, the five vital organs. Panchaprana, Manobuddhi, Deshendriya, Samanvitam. Apanchikrita, Bhudoham, Sukshmangam, Bhogasadhanam. This is the God has given us, or the power has given us, three things. One is the hutment of experience. You know, you need a tent. This is a tent. And the second one is the instrument of experience. The mind, not merely the mind. If the mind has to be there, we need panchapranas. Panchaprana, mano, buddhi, deshendriya, samanvitam. Organs of action, organs of perception. And the, according to them, you know, the rudimentary elements of the panchabhudas. All these things put together is called the sukshma sharira, the subtle body. For us laymen, we can say the mind, you know, the mind intellect complex, which is not palpable, which is not tangible, which is not, cannot be seen. The other one can be seen, grass, in grass form. So this one is called the tent of experience, the residence. In our shastras, you know, they say, panchendriya mahabhudam sambhavam karma sanjitam shariram sukadukhanam bhoga ayatanam uchyate. Bhoga ayatanam means hutment of experience. The other one is instrument of experience. And the causal body is how you came. Not merely the sukshma sharira is only an instrument. An instrument by itself cannot act. So what else behind this? So that is called the causal body. The uncaused cause behind everything. When you take once today what we ate? Rice, okay. The first pad, you know. We all know, those of you who are agriculturists will know, one paddy, when it is sown in a conducive atmosphere, after a period of 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, it sprouts. Then given the ambience, you know, it grows. And in 3 or 4 months' time, it flowers, pollination takes place, and first it comes in the form of a milk, in the husk, then it gets solidified, it becomes the rice. And when it reaches the level of maturity, it is harvested, threshing goes on, winnowing goes on, then it dries, then you put it in the huller, then you get the rice. This is what we have seen. So without this seed paddy, it cannot come. But what? Think about the first paddy. Think about the first tomato. Think about the first banana. How can it come? Will we be able to explain? Suppose somebody asks, who is my cause? I can say my parents. Their cause. Their parents. Their cause. Third, okay, great-grandfather, I can remember. Third, then I can say their cause, I mean, but I know very well, without them I cannot. So without a cause, I cannot come. So who should be that first? The first human being who had not had a parent. The first paddy seed which did not come from a paddy plant. The first tomato which has not come from a tomato. Just. So that is why they say anadya vidya avirvacha. It cannot be traced. So the causal body, when they say, the one which activates this instrument, sukshmanga, where from it has come? Oh. So until we reach and experience that, they have given us a name, uncaused cause. Somewhere to start with, you know, in mathematics we say x, then finally we find out x. Similarly, for enabling us to move further inward, to find out this, they say uncaused cause. So that is called the causal body. And sukshmanga means this mind-intellect complex, and this is the heart-mind-intellect. So here we are all now talking or hearing or sitting, absorbing all this because that power is there now. And we are making use of the instrument called these things to absorb, to hear, to do it. Through the sense organs it comes. But the sense organs may be there if the mind is not there. Suppose you are thinking about something and I am talking to you, you will not hear. Acha, the mind is there. Mind, where from it can come? During your deep sleep, the mind is not there. But you are still alive. Oh, acha, then who am I? Like this, we keep on going inside. Again, we get stuck. We again come back to the sense of individuality level. Again, we do that. Somewhere we have been told we will be able to trace the origin. And there, then this the explanation about the sukshma sharira, karana sharira, surya sharira, all these come because then we are trying to dissect or trying to understand the assumed personality of ours. When you say I am hungry, you feel you are the body. When I tell you, shall we go for a walk? No, I am not in a mood. That means you are the mind. When you are working on a project and you get a breakthrough, you know, said, I got it. Who got it? The intellect got it. So at that time, each time we are identifying ourselves with one or other. The world we live in is a school in which observation and experiences offer us innumerable opportunities for self-improvement. Nay, the world itself is God. World itself is Guru. The world we live in is a school in which observation and experiences, observation of other life, others' life, experience of one's own life, offer us innumerable opportunities for self-improvement. Nay, the world itself is God. World itself is Guru. With this, you know, when we try to go back, including today's experience, when you came here, when you sat, you did not plan that this question should be asked. When we came and sat, we did not know how to answer this question also. But it came spontaneously. Answer also came spontaneously. So then we start thinking, what is there for us to learn? This is how everything happens. Though we take over the ownership of our thoughts, this is how everything happens. Everything happens by itself. The food we have just eaten, no? The digestion goes on, you know, whether we order it or not. It goes on by itself. Automaton. Similarly, if you start watching yourself, automatically in the morning you get up, take the brush. You order, please go take the brush, no? Put the paste. Do the, no? Automatic, no? You can call it as reflex, whatever it may be, but it's all, you know, going automated. Everywhere you find everything goes on. So what is there for me to learn? Keep on thinking about it. We might find an answer. And in spirituality, one more thing is there. As many men, so many paths. It is not a structured path. If it is a structured path, one path is enough. Why so many interpretation, so many scriptures, so many gurus. Because each one is unique, so each one's path is also unique. Then you may ask, what is the use of scriptures or studying or this? Actually, those are all guidance. Handposts. How do you go to Gandhinagar from here? Somebody can guide again. We need some guidance. But ultimately, we have to travel by ourselves. We cannot look at the handposts. We will never reach there. Those are all serving, no doubt. Or putting it in another way, from 1st standard to 12th standard, you have common curriculum. Everybody has the same. But by the time you reach plus two, you know your taste, your aptitude, your temperament, your inclination, your priorities, your preferences. Then you choose your own line, You don't sit there after 12th, again in 12th. So this journey makes you aware of what is your line. So all spiritual institutions or spiritual disciplines offer us, it's a common curriculum. As we keep on traveling it, we will find, proportionate to the intensity we have, we will find the unique method. That also you have to bear in mind, so that we don't become our master used to say,
dumb-driven
cattle, correct. Each one has to bring out the original, finally. If you find, look at these masters of any faith, nobody followed any other. Each one is unique. And when they traveled, they place it before us, that's all. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa inspired Swami Vivekananda. But he was doing puja. His background is, Vivekananda did not go to the temple and start doing puja. Holy Mother also did not do that. If you take Ramana Bhagavan, it is a different thing. If you take Shivanji Maharaj, it's a different thing. Any saint you name, of any faith also. So then, that also we should know. Each one is unique, and therefore each one's path is also unique. So we started with, the concepts, spiritual discipline. So spiritual discipline offers us something by which we can pursue this exploration. If that is also not there, we may not get started. To some others, without that also they get started. But by and large, we start with, we go to a temple or we go to a place of worship, we offer something, we hear something, we think about something. That is the starting point. And ultimately this journey will give us so many revelations. And when we start thinking about this payback, suddenly we become aware, the proportionate to the intensity we have in that, we find amazingly opportunities, they well up before us, or we name everything as an opportunity. And there is a joy in it. Actually, the payback, when you say, there is nothing called value. And value education also, we should not say that, but we have no other term, that's why we are doing it. Because we should know in our heart, a value becomes value when only you don't recognize it. A value becomes a value only when you don't recognize it. It should become our sahaja swabhav. We are intrinsically that. But how to convey that? So we say value-based education, that's all. We hear so many experiences here. Suppose you are traveling. You are traveling in a train. You are moving toward the toilet. You see somebody sitting, an aged person, tottering, very near the door. And the door is open. What will be your immediate reaction? You don't have to know whether he is a known person, whether you expect something, nothing like that. What happens at that time? You become one with him, no? Simple question. I can say it's a value, compassion. Not to you. It's a spontaneous act, revelation. When I share with you, I can say it is an act of compassion, whatever you have written here, no? is an act of compassion. Just because I learn academically compassion, I will not become compassionate. Because it is a spontaneous act. So we try to understand all these things. This journey, you know, the spiritual journey is nothing but understanding, exploring, and where we find joy and joy and joy. So we will not say that we are helping, as she said, we are not, neither we are supporting nor helping. It is a spontaneous act. If we become conscious of it, then it is not. So we are all praying only to that power, don't make me conscious of it. That means you are not stepping. My assumed individuality is again taking that role. Without you, I become zero. With you, I am something. That being the fact, why are you making me feel that I do this, I do that? You have provided me a field. If somebody comes at your doorstep and says he or she has not had food for 2-3 days and looks emaciated, what will be your immediate spontaneous reaction? You will rush up to the langar, no? Take whatever you get, you will give it, that's all. And when he or she takes a couple of morsels of food, if they have not taken for 2-3 days, she will look at you with a heart full of love, and which you cannot explain that. Something wells up in your heart called present feeling or something like that. You are so happy. Acha, you have done it. When I see it, I say, oh, such a broad-minded man you are. That you did not because you thought I am broad-minded, no? It is spontaneous, you know? You suddenly identified yourself with him. What will happen if you don't take food? Suddenly you can understand that the sense of feelingness, commonness, that has taken over you, you are doing it. I am looking at and say you are broad-minded, you are compassionate, that's all. Immediately suppose you own that, finished. You are not enjoying it. Spiritual growing is nothing but handing over the ownership, assumed ownership to the real owner. Handing over the assumed ownership to the real owner in us. It is for that purpose all these things have come. Whereas then the Gandhiji used to say, when Vinobaji and Gandhiji moved by love, you know, this is called moved by love. Acha. There is a beautiful book called Moved by Love. In that, if we go through that, you will find when Vinobaji came after 1 year, Gandhiji said, asked him, no, before that there was one more incident. Gandhiji wrote his biography. So he gave to Vinobaji and asked his opinion. So Vinobaji said, you are a votary of truth. So you will write nothing but truth. Whether somebody appreciates it or not, that I cannot say. But it will not harm anybody. So immediately Gandhiji said, this is what I wanted. It will not harm anybody, you know, this is what I want. Because he says, ultimately we can only serve. And he showed like this. We have no role to play. We can only serve him in other form. And later on, Vinobaji, after 60 years of the noblest service, probably they are the only two saints who were living, who did not mark any constituency of devotees or forums or disciplines. To them, the entire humanity, entire creation was their constituency. And such persons, they say, master, authority on all Vedas, Shastras, everything. He says, ultimately, we have to become zero. What are you going to do? He asked. So he said, I am going to retire from all activities. It is something very touching. He says, now the Sukshma Karma Yoga, he said. That means, you know, you are retiring from, he said, I want to retire from all activities. So Gandhiji immediately says, oh, that means you are available to everybody, you know. Yes. But even if you identify yourself with a broader sense, okay, with a movement. Still, you know, somewhere in your heart, you have considered that as something more important than the rest of the movements. That is why you are identifying with it. According to them, that is violence. So total non-violence means where you get totally detached, available to everybody. Equal in every respect. When we start reading it, you know, that when we start thinking about it, oh, ultimately it zeroes to this, handing over the ownership to the real owner. We have an assumed ownership that also he has given to us, not that we asked, he has given to us to play with. But after some time, you know, he makes us to feel about the, we don't want to part with the assumed ownership. Sometime more we try to keep it. But the spiritual growing will enable us to slowly hand over this ownership to that. So if all of us start thinking about it, even the very act of sitting 1 hour is to withdraw from our common activities, common run of things. Physical activities first. It is an attempt to watch the real owner and to distinguish between the assumed owner. This is what we felt when we came here, when all of you were sitting and trying to experience the silence. When we came and sat, oh, today this is the learning he gives me. Hey, look here, this is the ultimate. This is the process by which the assumed ownership comes to become aware of the assumed ownership and tries to hand it over to the real owner.
What is the purpose of the life?
Good. When we start asking the question, it cannot be answered. Each one has to define. Because at this moment, if we have to accept the somebody's words, it will be only a word. We will not be able to accept it. Each one has to plumb deep within and find out. It's a very nice question. What is the purpose of my life? So initially we can say, you know, to give back, okay. Because I know that I came with nothing and I know I am going to go without nothing also. In between I have been able to, I take so many things, I pay back. Another thing would be to know myself, who the real am I. Third thing is to know the object's emotions and thought in its own place. It has been given, you know. I did not create it. So each one I try to go and ultimately I will be led. And another school of thought will be, the purpose of my life is to know that which makes me complete. The life starts from a sense of incompleteness and we move towards this sense of completeness. So in which category we, each one has to find out for oneself. They say, we have been told that it is an inquiry for making ourselves full. Purna. We are full, we have forgotten about that. It is not that we are acquiring something or attaining something, we are realizing something. That is why it's called self-realization, God-realization. We are basically, intrinsically, essentially, we are that. We have forgotten. So we try to become aware. This is the purpose of our life. So whether it is okay for us, each one has to try. It can be in any form. Traditional, non-traditional, everything is okay. We have to find out. The other day in the ashram, one young man came, just like, you know, you asked me. So he came at about 2:30, so we asked him, had your food? No. You first go and have your food. When they came back, you know, we had to go for another program. So we normally give some prasad and then we try to get up. Then they sat. Then I was looking internally, the young man, he said, I am looking at my hand. I am not the hand. Who really am I? I can see the body. I can feel the body. I cannot be the body. But I am very much with the body. I am not available there. I am only available here. But I know I am not the body. Who really am I? A simple question, you know. A profound question. excellent question. But every time we should know, God places that person there for our self-improvement. That should be all the questions that have come here. It is all for that, to get us more and more clarity on what is to be ultimately scaled. So these questions are wonderful questions. You may not get the answer. The answer which we said, it's our answer, it's not your answer. So the answer you have to get by yourself. But it might help. What is the purpose of my life? We begin with the realization that the witness is an ever-present consciousness. Witness, capital W. Witness is an ever-present consciousness even when we doubt its existence. What is being tried in this 1 hour, you know? Every week, religiously, you are doing it. The observer is there. Sarvadi Sakshi Bhudam. No? We begin with the realization that the witness is an ever-present consciousness even when we doubt its existence. You are right now aware of, let us be here, no? You are right now be aware of, say, these words, the room, a window, people around you. You can sit back and simply notice that you are aware of all those objects floating by. Sounds float through the air. Thoughts float through the mind. And when you notice them, you are effortlessly aware of them. Sit down. Is there any effort? There is a simple, effortless, spontaneous witnessing of whatever happens to be present. There is a simple, effortless witnessing of, you are hearing these words, you know. You are aware that you are sitting. You are aware that the bulb is burning. The fan is moving. No efforts, you know. Effortless. There is a simple, effortless, spontaneous witnessing of whatever happens to be present. When you rest in this simple, clear, ever witness, you are resting in the great unborn. You are resting in the intrinsic spirit. You are resting in infinite freedom. You cannot be seen. You have no qualities at all. You are not this, you are not that. You are not an object. You are the opening or clearing in which the entire manifest world arises right now. But you do not arise in it. It arises in you, in this vast emptiness and freedom that you are. When you rest in the simple, clear, ever-present witness, you are resting in the great unborn. You are resting in intrinsic spirit. You are resting in infinite freedom. You cannot be seen. You have no qualities at all. You are not this, you are not that. You are not an object. You are the opening or clearing in which the entire manifest world arises right now. You do not arise in it. It arises in you, in this vast emptiness and freedom that you are. Spirit cannot be grasped or reached or sought or seen. It is the ever-present seer. How could you possibly search for that which is right now aware of these words? How could you possibly search for that which is right now aware of these words? You are that. You cannot go out looking for that which is the looker. You cannot go out looking for that which is the looker. When you are not an object, you are God. In your every weekly session, it might help. This journey will definitely help. That which is being witnessed, that which witnesses, these two become clearer. The universal consciousness, the individual consciousness, the purpose of life, the payback, all. Everything, you know, the scriptures, the personal form of worship of this God principle, impersonal worship of God, everything will become clearer and clearer and clearer. I will again read the last one. Spirit cannot be grasped or reached or sought or seen. It is the ever-present seer. How could you possibly search for that which is right now aware of these words? You are that. You cannot go out looking for that which is the looker. You cannot go out for looking for that which is the looker. When you are not an object, you are God. So Brahman, Atman, no? Sukshma Sharira, Sula Sharira, Karana Sharira, everything. Anyhow, we are deeply thankful to all of you. Gave us an opportunity to bring all these things, you know. And the most important thing is that you have started with observing silence. Because that is the answer. Final answer is that. This awareness can be realized only in utter silence. And once the awareness is realized, then any activity can be undertaken, because our master used to say, every thought, every word, every deed will bear the stamp of divinity. So this is very important. Very, very important.